We are now moving ahead to our very interesting debate on the COVID-19 pandemic vaccination campaign. I would like to inform you that we will go over point 15 on the debate and point 16 on the resolution on the COVID-19 pandemic vaccination campaign together. So whoever wants to speak either for point 15 or point 16, you can use it during this debate. We can start now with our 2 points, 15 and 16. And I would like to welcome Hans-Henry Kluge, the Regional Director for Europe of the World Health Organization. Dear Dr. Kluge, it's great to have you here today with us. I want to welcome you at the Committee of the Regions plenary for this very interesting discussion and debate. And I would like to say that since the outbreak of COVID 1 year ago, more than 2 million people have tragically lost their lives, as we all know by now. The EU agreed an unprecedented budget, investment and vaccine plan, and in this common effort, cohesion and solidarity must be our guiding compass. We must avoid competition for vaccines between member states and within member states. We must put all our efforts in avoiding a vaccine divide between our regions, cities, villages, which would create health inequalities and exacerbate people's difficulties. Solidarity, not a needless vaccine war led by nationalism, is the only path back to normality. We must hold companies legally accountable, but controlling the distribution of medicine is anti-European, while restricting their export needs clear rules. We also need a better use of our medical research to protect every European citizen and benefit the world. The pandemic has shown that we need to make our communities more resilient, and all our governments at European, national and regional level more responsive. We have to analyze and, if needed, rethink the EU's competencies in health, and we need to be open to changing our governance structures. Local and regional governments are a vital partner, not a second-class player, in preparing, responding, managing and recovering from disasters. We also need to be united in the face of misinformation. Local and regional leaders are the most trusted level of government in Europe and play a fundamental role to tackle the lies about the safety of medicines. As representatives of all EU's regional and local authorities, we stand ready to launch an EU-wide campaign with the European Commission and the World Health Organization. Ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, today our committee will sign its action plan with the World Health Organization right at the end of this debate. In this context, I welcome Dr. Kluge and we thank him and the World Health Organization for their tireless effort and their tireless work throughout this year, especially during the pandemic. We must think and act both globally and locally to tackle pandemics, to save lives, and to secure jobs. Dr. Kluge, I would welcome the World Health Organization as a partner of our 2021 local and regional barometer, so together we can assess and review how to improve health resilience in our regions, cities and villages. Let us all hope that the light at the end of the tunnel that we can now finally see is not that far. And let us try to unite our forces, and with the help of the European Union, of the World Health Organization, not only to tackle this huge health crisis, but at the same time to work all together for the recovery. The recovery of the European Union, the recovery of our regions, our cities and villages. And we can win, we can prevail, and we will. Dr. Kluge, the floor is yours.
Dear President Apostolos Tsitsikostas, representatives of the region, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, I am very happy to be here today at the European Committee of the Regions to both sign an agreement to continue the productive partnership between our two organizations, as well as to discuss COVID-19. In times like these, the unwavering support of the European Union and its institutions to the World Health Organization, building on the past, collaborating in the present, and planning for the future is crucial. I'd like to express my appreciation for the European Union support in recent weeks to strengthening the international health regulations on which WHO bases much of its emergency preparedness and response work, as well as the key role that the EU has played in establishing the COVAX facility within the vaccine pillar of the Access to COVID-19 Tools Act Accelerator. As the President was telling, we are now more than 1 year into an unprecedented pandemic. To date, the European region is the second worst affected of all world regions, accounting for more than one third of both reported cases and deaths globally. Some 37 countries in the region have started vaccinations, administering close to 30 million doses. The development and approval of safe, effective vaccines less than a year after the emergence of a new virus is a stunning scientific achievement. But let me be clear. COVID-19 vaccines are not a silver bullet that can stop this pandemic by themselves, but they will reduce the burden of disease and save lives. It is very important to explain to the people why the vaccination is aiming for now. First, it aims to protect the people most vulnerable, the elderly people, and the people most exposed, the healthcare workers. So it is not yet to eliminate or eradicate, and to have this narrative very clearly explained to the people is crucial, particularly as the narrative of vaccines. We know also a lot of discussions about the AstraZeneca. Sometimes the narrative for the people comes as a little bit complex and confusing. And that's why a very simple, clear communication strategy from the governments, from the leaders of the regions, is so important to the people, that they know what is the plan, when am I going to be vaccinated, and let's take this unprecedented interest of the people into health as a positive moment, a educational moment. We should not forget that this is not routine immunization. My friends, this is pandemic immunization, the largest, most ambitious global vaccination effort in history since Edward Jenner in 1796 for the first time inoculated the cowpox vaccine. And as we predicted, the demand for vaccines is far greater than the supply at this very early stage. The sheer scale of vaccine rollout is enormous, and so are the challenges. Frustration due to an inconsistent flow of vaccines is understandable. Vaccine production and rollout will take time. The key here is solidarity. I will always advocate for solidarity as a moral principle, but also a pragmatic principle. It has to deal with regional and global security. No one is safe until everyone is safe. Producing sufficient doses of the vaccines depends on international cooperation. If countries come together through research, manufacturing capacity, procurement, and investment in delivery, unprecedented speed can be achieved. We are seeing many positive developments. Otherwise, competing pharmaceutical companies are now agreeing to help each other to boost the production capacity. And I also saw statements in this regard from the President of the European Commission. The WHO has repeatedly called for action to ensure fair and equitable access to COVID-19 vaccines. It is a global public good. No one country, no one region should have access to more than it needs while other countries and regions have limited or no supplies. This is why the COVAX facility is of such importance. A fair distribution of vaccines is the right thing to do for moral, economic and security reasons. That is why I call to the people of Europe for patience and understanding. I also understand, until the production capacity of COVID-19 vaccines is getting up to speed, it's normal that there will be some collision between international solidarity and national responsibility. But I'm confident that some delays in vaccine production will be compensated by new products coming to the market and by ramping up the production capacity. So yes, there is reason for hope in the form of vaccines, but we are far from being out of the woods. We all know about the variants, the virus of concern. As of today, in the European region, the pan-European region, 37 countries have reported variants of concern, of which 17, the virus originally identified in South Africa. This is not a new virus. It will not bring another second pandemic. It does not change the way how to fight the virus. But it is a cruel reminder that the virus still has the upper hand. Somehow, it is a normal evolution of a virus that tries to survive in its human host. But am I concerned? Yes, I am concerned. Because first, the virus transmits faster. More people being infected. It means that health systems, which are stressed today, will have more difficulties tomorrow. Number two, we are very vigilant, watching what it means for the effectiveness of the vaccines. And third, there are some preliminary reports which show that people can be reinfected with the new variant. The impact of the pandemic is therefore far-reaching and long-term. Its effect on mental health is felt everywhere, in every quarter of our society. There is a parallel pandemic of mental health issues. And that's why WHO is launching the Mental Health Coalition under the auspices of the Queen of all Belgians, Queen Mathilde, who is appointed by the United Nations Secretary General as the Sustainable Development Goal Advocate for Health. COVID-19 has also exacerbated risks of food insecurity and scarcity. while unhealthy diets have added to the burden of non-communicable diseases. The pandemic further disrupted health services and forced national health systems to reallocate resources. Today is World Cancer Day. It is concerning to acknowledge that one in three countries in the European region have partially or completely disrupted cancer services, directly impacting the chances of cure or survival for hundreds of thousands of cancer patients. This morning, with the President of Georgia, I launched the WHO Pan-European Initiative on Cancer, United Action Against Cancer, with the ambitious goal to end cancer as a life-threatening disease in the European region. And I appointed a WHO European Cancer Ambassador, Mr. Arne Andersen from Sweden. The initiative will go from grassroots to the political level. And with the head of state of Georgia, we are very committed, as we agreed with the health commissioner, Dr. Stella Kyriakides, to have synergies, close collaboration with the Europe Beating Cancer Plan. And congratulations to Commissioner Kyriakides for having launched the plan today. Dear colleagues, dear friends, what we have seen over the past months in our cities and towns, where two-thirds of the population of the European region lives, is that strong local governance is a factor behind successful pandemic mitigation. Local governments, regions, have been and are at the forefront of curtailing the pandemic. Cities are epicenters in this emergency, not only in terms of community and countrywide transmission, but also as points of healthcare and travel and trade hubs. Cities are the closest level of government to people. And during my first meeting with President Tsitsikostas, I reassured him how committed I am to the cities, to the regions. Because they are also key to sharing experiences and fighting misinformation as service providers and central elements of a sustainable future. A couple of months ago, I established the Pan-European Commission on Health and Sustainable Development, led by former European Commissioner and former Prime Minister of Italy, Professor Mario Monti. The findings will be presented at the WHO European Region Committee in September this year. I tasked this independent commission with rethinking policy priorities in the light of pandemics. Current challenges call for rethinking our priorities and finding new ways of working. The European region is fortunate to have already made strides in that direction, seeking to achieve equity in health and understanding the critical relevance of its social, economic, and environmental determinants, because this is not the last pandemic. The Monti Commission is closely looking at the interactions between human health, animal health, environmental health, and antimicrobial resistance. We know by the year 2040, 70% of the world population will live in cities. Respected colleagues and friends, you have such an important governance role. Today, WHO Europe and the Committee of the Regions, as Mr. President was mentioning, will be renewing our partnership by signing a new Memorandum of Understanding, as well as an accompanying action plan based on my vision, the European Programme of Work 2020-2025, United Action for Better Health in Europe, EPW. The political priorities of the European Committee of the Regions in 2020-25, its annual work programs, and the new European Commission Programme for Health 2021-27 form the bedrock on which our partnership lies. This is a significant milestone towards bringing our work in line with our targets. Our partnership, I strongly believe, is about meeting people's expectations to their governments to secure universal healthcare without financial hardship, making the most of the knowledge and governance of 1 million local and regional European politicians in terms of health in their constituency, and a robust post-COVID-19 recovery with resilient health systems and strong primary healthcare for thriving communities. I hope that I can count on the full involvement of the Committee of the Regions in WHO's flagship initiatives, the Mental Health Coalition, Empowerment Through Digital Health, the European Immunization Agenda 2030, and Healthier Behaviors. I would like to thank the Committee of the Regions for its participation at last September's session of the WHO Region Committee for Europe, with member Birgitta Sakrideus underlining the role of local regional authorities in the fight against COVID-19. And let me also thank the Committee of the Regions for lending its strong voice to the COVID-19 vaccination campaign. Finally, let me express my most sincere thanks to President Apostolos Tsitsikostas and our friends at European Committee of the Regions for making this agreement a reality. With this goodwill and commitment, I look forward to bringing our common vision of equitable health for all in the European region to life. Thank you very much.
Mr. Kluge, I thank you very much, not only for being here today to discuss this very, very interesting topic, but also for the great, the fantastic work you have done in the World Health Organization. We are lucky as Europeans and as European leaders to have you in charge of the World Health Organization in Europe. And the agreements and the work, the collaboration that we have will be strengthened even more in the future, starting today. And I want you to know that the Committee of the Regions and all the regions and cities in Europe will stand as strong allies of the World Health Organization and of yourself. So thank you again for this introductory remark, and I would like to give the floor now to Olgerd Geblevich from the EPP.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. Dear Mr. Kluge, on behalf of the EPP group, I would like to thank you for very stimulating intervention. I believe that by drawing right conclusions from the COVID-19 health crisis and offering solutions for the future preparedness and response, the WHO can inspire trust and provide guidance for regional and local governments across Europe. It is important now more than ever that global organizations such as WHO can work together with all levels of governments to protect lives and livelihoods. We trust in common European approach for procurement of vaccines. The alternative would be total chaos, resulting in the 27 member states competing for the vaccines, thus leaving many Europeans behind. Therefore, now is the moment for us to express our full support for the leadership of the Commission in urging the developers to step up the production and speed up the supply of vaccine. Mr. Kluge, my region, West Pomerania region in Poland, as well as many other regions and local governments in Europe, have the responsibility for preparing the infrastructure, medical equipment, healthcare workforces needed to carry out the vaccinations. As the level closest to the citizens, we are ready to support the national vaccination strategies and campaigns with a transparent, targeted and reliable communication. In parallel, we all have to continue to follow the safety measures put in place in our countries and regions to contain the spread of the virus. But we will only get out of this crisis and defeat COVID-19 when all people have access to safe and efficient vaccines. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Mr. Giblevich. And I would like to give the floor now to a visionary European regional leader and the person who has done a fantastic work in her region in tackling the pandemic, Madrid, Ms. Isabel Diaz Ayuso. Isabel, the floor is yours.
¿Qué tal? Muy buenas tardes a todos. Muchísimas gracias, querido presidente, y gracias al doctor Kluge por su exposición. Queridos amigos del Comité de las Regiones, como todo el mundo sabe, Europa se está enfrentando a esta tercera ola, a este COVID-19 que ya ha afrontado 20 millones de europeos y que ha dejado casi medio millón de fallecidos, 100.000 en este último mes. Ya tenemos a tres empresas, a tres laboratorios con las vacunas facilitadas por la Agencia Europea del Medicamento, pero esto no es suficiente. Las regiones tenemos la responsabilidad, muchas de ellas en materia sanitaria, y tenemos que afrontar esta situación. Por un lado, Madrid ha puesto en marcha un nuevo hospital con más de 1.000 camas, que precisamente lo que intenta hacer es lo que hablaba el doctor Kluge, para no tener que posponer operaciones ni pruebas, y hemos realizado más de 5 millones de test de antígenos para cortar las cadenas de transmisión. Pero tenemos que seguir aplicando otras medidas, los cierres selectivos para evitar que no perjudiquemos todavía más a la economía, como está sucediendo en muchos sitios, que esto sobre todo perjudica precisamente a la salud mental y también al ánimo de nuestros ciudadanos, y aún así más. Y para ello lo que hace falta es volver a hablar nuevamente de la vacunación, porque no llegan las vacunas y necesitamos urgentemente más dosis. Tenemos que estudiar la posibilidad incluso de que se pueda fabricar en todos los países de la Unión Europea negociando la patente. Tenemos que estudiar todas las posibilidades que están en nuestra mano, buscar estrategias comunes también en las fronteras para poder competir unidos. Ya, todavía estamos un 3% de europeos vacunados, solo hay 3% frente al 58%. Por ejemplo, en Israel, o el 14,5 de la Unión Europea. Y, por tanto, tenemos que estar todos a la altura y juntos intentar combatir esta lacra. Porque sería catastrófico para nuestra salud, para nuestra economía y también algo muy importante para la imagen común de este proyecto de ciudadanos libres e iguales que es la Unión Europea. Por tanto, tenemos que estudiar la manera de seguir comprando vacunas y de acabar de una vez por todas en un ruego desesperado con esta situación de emergencia. Quiero agradecer el papel que ha jugado el Comité de las Regiones y en este caso su presidente, un gran líder europeo, por traer este debate y espero que aprobemos hoy esta resolución. Pero sí, es un ruego desesperado a la Unión Europea para poner sobre la mesa este debate, conseguir ya por fin estas vacunas de una manera que ahora ya es desesperada. Estamos teniendo del orden de 3.000 muertos al día y no podemos seguir así. Esto es un dolor insoportable. Un lastre para nosotros, para nuestro proyecto común, insisto, y por eso estoy convencida de que tenemos que poner todo aquello que esté en nuestra mano para traer esas vacunas y para demostrar que somos un proyecto libre, como digo, de ciudadanos que trabajan de manera conjunta por todos los ciudadanos, empezando por los más vulnerables. Muchísimas gracias a todos.
Subido, ¿eh? Thank you very much. Isabel, the floor now to Natalie Sarabezoles from the PES Group.
Oui, merci Monsieur le Président. Monsieur le Directeur, en premier lieu, je souhaiterais vous remercier pour votre présence parmi nous aujourd'hui. L'Organisation mondiale de la santé a fait un travail important à la suite de l'émergence de la pandémie en 2019 et ce travail, même si on peut toujours mieux faire, aura permis de sauver des vies, de nombreuses vies. Aujourd'hui, en Europe, nous sommes dans la phase de vaccination et je suis fière de rappeler que conformément au principe de ma famille politique, la solidarité, un principe autant moral que pragmatique, vous le disiez juste avant, la solidarité a prévalu en Europe. Les États membres de l'Union européenne, quelle que soit leur taille, ont obtenu les vaccins le même jour. Cependant, et cela a été dit par d'autres orateurs, aujourd'hui les problèmes importants apparaissent, notamment avec les grandes entreprises pharmaceutiques qui ne respectent pas leurs engagements. On peut craindre l'apparition d'un nationalisme vaccinal et à ce sujet, je souhaiterais vous demander quel est le plan de l'OMS pour faire face à cette situation que vous avez décrite vous-même tout à l'heure. En effet, on peut craindre que la coopération internationale ne soit remise en cause alors qu'elle est à la base de la lutte contre un virus qui ne connaît bien évidemment ni loi ni frontières. Dans l'avis du comité des régions concernant le programme européen pour la santé, il est préconisé de doter l'Union d'importantes capacités de production de matériel médical, mais de médicaments aussi. Et par ailleurs, au-delà de l'Union européenne, il est essentiel de faire jouer la solidarité également et d'éviter la concurrence territoriale afin de permettre l'égalité face à la vaccination. Je crois donc à ce sujet que l'Organisation mondiale de la santé a une grande responsabilité pour maintenir la coopération et j'espère que vous pourrez nous donner des pistes de travail sur lesquelles vous travaillez. Nous notons aussi, dans plusieurs pays de l'Union, que les États ne s'appuient pas assez sur leurs régions et leurs villes pour accélérer la vaccination avec les stocks existants. Déjà, nos territoires avaient été en première ligne pour faire face aux premiers effets de la pandémie, malgré le manque de transparence et le manque de confiance apparent. Vous l'avez dit, les collectivités étaient le fer de lance de la lutte contre la pandémie et le premier interlocuteur des citoyennes et des citoyens. Donc, votre organisation aurait-elle des recommandations en termes de décentralisation, des réponses publiques pour faire face à une pandémie et pour être plus efficace? Et enfin, je souhaiterais aborder une dernière question avec vous. Votre organisation peut clairement nous aider à mieux nous préparer aux futures pandémies. Vous l'avez dit, ce n'est pas la dernière. Il semble en effet aujourd'hui que nous n'y échapperons plus. Que nous conseillez-vous de mettre en œuvre? Plus de coopération à l'échelle européenne? Enfin, vous avez vous-même abordé le sujet. Diriez-vous qu'il faut maintenant songer à renforcer les compétences de l'Union européenne en matière de santé, en nous appuyant en particulier sur les collectivités territoriales? C'est peut-être un petit peu en dehors de votre domaine, mais vous l'avez vous-même abordé et je trouve intéressant d'avoir votre avis. C'est en tout cas ce que nous défendons, nous, au sein du groupe PSE du Comité européen des régions. Je vous remercie de votre attention et pour vos réponses à venir. Et encore une fois, merci d'être parmi nous aujourd'hui.
Thank you very much for your intervention. I would like to give the floor now to Francisco Higuera Arizcueta from Renew Europe Group. The floor now to Roberto Ciampetti from the ECR Group.
Grazie Presidente. In qualità di relatore del Comitato delle Regioni sul futuro dell'Unione della Salute, questo argomento mi sta particolarmente a cuore. Nessun cittadino, nessuna impresa, nessuna regione e nessuno Stato si è potuto sottrarre alla pandemia. Questa infatti ha colpito tutto il mondo, dalla Cina fino alla mia regione, il Veneto, dove sono Presidente del Consiglio regionale. Nei primi giorni della pandemia assistemmo a una guerra commerciale tra gli Stati membri per l'approvvigionamento delle mascherine e ora, a quasi un anno dall'inizio della stessa, vediamo che alcuni Stati membri stanno bypassando gli accordi comunitari per ottenere ulteriori dosi di vaccino tramite accordi bilaterali, mettendo in discussione il principio di solidarietà fra gli Stati membri. Noi abbiamo accolto con ottimismo la decisione dell'Unione Europea di adottare una strategia comune in materia di vaccinazione, ma siamo delusi per gli scarsi progressi compiuti. L'entusiasmo del 27 dicembre, data in cui i primi paesi hanno iniziato a vaccinare in pubblico, sembra ormai un ricordo troppo lontano. In Italia, come in molti altri paesi, abbiamo dovuto rivedere i piani per la distribuzione dei vaccini, dopo che le aziende farmaceutiche come la Pfizer hanno annunciato che avrebbero ridotto le dosi pattuite. E adesso ci troviamo a dover far di tutto per far sì che i cittadini che hanno assunto la prima dose possano ricevere la seconda. Se davvero vogliamo raggiungere l'obiettivo di una quota di vaccinati pari al 70% entro l'estate, è ora di cambiare rotta. E allora io le chiedo, come possiamo garantire che le multinazionali farmaceutiche non cambino all'ultimo momento la quantità di dosi di vaccino concordate da consegnare agli Stati membri? Se non incrementiamo la disponibilità di dosi e se non acceleriamo sulla diffusione dei vaccini, costringeremo un numero sempre maggiore di paesi di rivolgersi direttamente alle aziende farmaceutiche. Vi sono state molte discussioni sulla trasparenza dei contratti sui vaccini firmati dalla Commissione europea. Questo ha senz'altro contribuito a rafforzare la disinformazione e incertezza che circonda la vaccinazione. In questo momento dovremmo informare e incoraggiare i cittadini a vaccinarsi. Secondo quanto riporta Eurovigilance, il database europeo per la gestione e l'analisi delle segnalazioni di sospette reazioni avverse ai medicinali autorizzati, in Europa il 30 gennaio 2021 sono stati segnalati 26.849 eventi avversi al vaccino Covid-Pfizer. Lo stato con più eventi avversi è stato circa il 32,55% è l'Italia, con 8.740 casi, di cui 7.800 classificati gravi. Le risulta e qual è la sua valutazione statistica su questo? Grazie.
Grazie mille a Francisco Illea Arisqueta from Renew Europe, please.
Sí, muchas gracias, señor presidente. Efectivamente, nos enfrentamos al momento más dramático de la Unión Europea, a su momento más decisivo. Como muy bien se ha dicho, miles de personas pierden sus vidas cada día en nuestra Unión Europea. Pero no solo eso, nuestra economía está en peligro y también nuestro proyecto político de una Europa unida. Si los ciudadanos no ven en este momento la respuesta eficaz de Europa, el proyecto estará en peligro. Por eso hay que agradecer a la Unión Europea su política de compra agregada de vacunas. Y por eso es muy importante que se aclaren todas las dudas, que consigamos vacunar con rapidez y que consigamos transmitir a la población algo que para nosotros es muy importante. Durante una crisis, durante el hundimiento de un barco, no se pueden subastar los chalecos salvavidas en un cuarto oscuro. En esta crisis no puede ser que el libre mercado funcione con una pistola apuntando a la cabeza de los compradores. Para fijar precios, para tener vacunas, tenemos que mantener también los principios del libre mercado, pero también del derecho humanitario, también de la solidaridad, también de que todos seremos iguales en esta crisis. Eso es lo que tiene que transmitir ahora Europa a sus ciudadanos, a los países que viven en la Unión Europea. En esta crisis nadie quedará atrás, no dejaremos a nadie atrás, nos comportaremos como lo que somos, como un proyecto de solidaridad, como un proyecto de civismo, y defenderemos naturalmente la iniciativa privada, que es la que hace que sean posibles los avances, que sea posible el desarrollo, pero tiene que hacerse con justicia y tiene que hacerse con transparencia. No puede haber más contratos ocultos. Tenemos que ser la comunidad poderosa, sí, que defiende a sus ciudadanos, sí, pero que lo hace también con transparencia y con solidaridad. Les hablo hoy desde una región en la que uno de cada 1.000 de nuestros ciudadanos se encuentra hoy ingresado en nuestros hospitales. Les hablo hoy desde un país que pide a la Unión Europea que demuestre su fuerza y su poder, pero también su cohesión y sus criterios comunes. Tenemos que hacer también un llamado al Centro Europeo de Control de Enfermedades para que seamos capaces de implementar medidas homogéneas, con criterios homogéneos, que todos los ciudadanos entiendan que las restricciones que son necesarias las tomamos todos de acuerdo y las tomamos solo bajo los criterios de la evidencia científica. Este es el momento definitivo para la Unión Europea y estoy seguro de que con la ayuda de todos saldremos adelante y que este proyecto, el proyecto de una Europa de ciudadanos libres e iguales, se verá reforzado después de esta crisis. Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much. The floor now to Carl van Loewe from the EA Group.
Thank you, President. Thank you, Dr. Kluge. Ik zal Nederlands spreken, Dr. Kluge, maar ik weet dat we ook samen West-Vlaams zouden kunnen spreken. Hier vandaag is het inderdaad een heel belangrijk en ook zeer gevoelig thema. Inderdaad, de solidariteit tussen lidstaten, tussen deelstaten, tussen regio's moet voorop staan. Het afgelopen jaar hebben we door de COVID al meer dan 500.000 Europeanen verloren. Onze gezondheidssystemen kwamen onder druk te staan en onze fundamentele rechten en vrijheden werden aan banden gelegd. Om de sociale, ook zeker de economische en natuurlijk de gezondheidsimpact een halt toe te roepen, rekenen we volop op de uitrol van de vaccinatie. Helaas moeten we vaststellen dat er toch nog steeds problemen zijn. Het gaat traag, er is soms een gebrek aan transparantie en het gaat ook niet altijd efficiënt. Er was ook de openlijke ruzie tussen de Europese Commissie en AstraZeneca, die bijna uitmondde in een diplomatieke rel. Het zogenaamd vaccinationalisme, waar er eerst voor werd gewaarschuwd, werd plots een strategie om de voorraad vaccins in de Europese Unie te vrijwaren. Dat dit een uiterst explosieve situatie zou creëren tussen het Verenigd Koninkrijk en Ierland, door het artikel van het Noord-Iers protocol fout heeft toe te passen, was men blijkbaar jammer genoeg vergeten. Maar vanzelfsprekend is de trage vaccinatie niet enkel de verantwoordelijkheid van de Europese Unie, maar ook lidstaten, deelstaten, lokale overheden moeten hun verantwoordelijkheid opnemen en solidariteit tonen. Zeker aangezien zij dicht bij de burger staan en dus de ogen en de oren zijn op het terrein. Ook wij hier in Vlaanderen, die nu volop bezig zijn, die vaccinatiecampagne uitrollen met vaccinatiedorpen en testdorpen. Willen we het draagvlak voor de vaccinatie bij de bevolking versterken, hebben we nood aan meer transparantie, meer efficiëntie. Zowel de Europese Commissie, de andere beleidsniveaus, ons comité van de regio's, de farmabedrijven kunnen het beter doen. En dit in het belang van onze volksgezondheid om zo snel mogelijk terug te keren naar een vrije samenleving.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. The floor now to Caroline Duane Stanley from the Greens. Okay, so we move on now and we open the floor to our members for 1 minute each. Let me start with our first Vice President, Vasco Cordeiro.
Thank you, President. I think that the issues that were brought to our attention, not only through the invitation of not only through the intervention of our guest, but also from the members, carry through three or four messages very, very important at this time. First, transparency. Second, leadership, the way Europe is dealing with this issue right now. Third, the common effort to achieve a united front against the pandemic. And also, the need to stress the point concerning transparency, not only at European level, but also at national level. I think this is one of the areas where the way we fight this pandemic can not only be related with the health issues, but also from a democratic point of view of strengthening the position of the European Union and strengthening the position of the national and local and regional authorities. Thank you, President.
Thank you very much, Vasco, for being on time, and thank you also for chairing part of the plenary earlier today. I would like to give the floor now to Caroline Duane Stanley from the Greens, who is connected. Okay, there seems to be a problem, I guess. So we will move to Gunther Platter, please. Miss Paola Fernandez Viana.
Sí, gracias. Gracias, presidente. Señor Kluge, defiendo la idea de que las vacunas contra el COVID-19 han de ser consideradas como un bien público mundial. Esta pandemia nos ha puesto a prueba, pone a prueba nuestros principios y nuestros valores fundamentales. Haber desarrollado y aprobado vacunas seguras y eficaces en menos de un año desde que apareció el virus es un logro científicamente increíble, pero ahora hay que garantizar el éxito en la distribución de las vacunas. Y hay que hacerlo conforme a los principios de equidad, de eficacia de respeto a lo acordado y de solidaridad. Quiero destacar el peligro real que existe actualmente en cuanto al suministro de vacunas. En mi región, por ejemplo, en Cantabria, nos preocupa la escasez y los incumplimientos por parte de las empresas farmacéuticas. No se puede jugar con la vida de las personas. En Cantabria, como en otras regiones europeas, contamos con un sistema sanitario muy preparado y bien organizado para administrar las dosis. Pedimos que la Unión Europea, la Organización Mundial de la Salud, presionen a las empresas farmacéuticas para que entreguen las dosis de las vacunas que están establecidas en los contratos. Es necesario que los gobiernos, los fabricantes de las vacunas y la comunidad internacional actúen de manera urgente para llevar a la práctica el imperativo de la equidad en la administración de las vacunas, que, repito, acabo como empecé, deben de ser consideradas un bien público mundial. Muchas gracias, presidente.
Muchas gracias. Mr. Sausberger, please.
Ja, Herr Präsident, meine Damen und Herren, liebe Kolleginnen und Kollegen, ich möchte nur ganz kurz auf die Entschließung eingehen, und zwar auf den Punkt 14, denn es geht ja im Wesentlichen darum, welche Konsequenzen wir auch ziehen. Aber als Konsequenz der Corona-Pandemie nun eine Debatte über europarechtliche Kompetenzfragen im Gesundheitsbereich anzustoßen, das greift meines Erachtens doch etwas zu kurz. Es müssen vielmehr die Erfahrungen mit der gemeinsamen europäischen Impfstrategie zum Anlass genommen werden, die Reaktionen der EU, der Mitgliedstaaten und der Regionen und Kommunen auf den Ausbruch der Covid-19-Pandemie umfassend zu evaluieren, sowie daraus die richtigen Schlussfolgerungen für die Zukunft zu ziehen. Darüber hinaus möchten wir in unserem Abänderungsantrag, dass die Zulassungsverfahren für die Covid-19-Impfstoffe und die Verhandlungen über den Zugang zu den Impfstoffen auch transparent geführt werden. Das wurde ja schon mehrfach erwähnt. Dies ist notwendig, um das immer mehr schwindende Vertrauen der Bevölkerung in diese Verfahren und in die Verhandlungen zu stärken. Und ich würde mich daher sehr freuen, wenn hier eine Mehrheit unserem Abänderungsantrag zustimmen könnte.
Thank you. Mr. Voss Bernd. The floor is yours.
Ja, vielen Dank, Herr Präsident. Vielen Dank, Herr Dr. Kluge. Es bleibt für uns Grünen dabei. Der europäische Ansatz ist der richtige Ausweg aus der Krise. Nationale Alleingänge sind nicht die richtige Antwort. Wir brauchen europäische Koordinierung, Transparenz, Effektivität und Sicherheit. Und dafür muss natürlich auch Transparenz für die Verzögerung bei der Lieferung der Impfstoffe hergestellt werden. Und da kommt die Kommission und der Rat, und das ist völlig natürlich, werden sich kritisieren lassen müssen, dass sie der Pharma-Lobby zu sehr nachgegeben haben und die Umstiftverträge ja zu intransparent sind und zu sehr mit Geheimhaltung belegt sind. Und es wird schon wohl überlegt werden müssen, ob der Artikel 122 aus dem EU-Vertrag gezogen wird, werden muss, um Patente freizugeben, um mögliche Kapazitäten für die Produktion von Impfstoffen, die wir auch in Europa haben, auszuschöpfen. Wir werden den Kampf gegen das Virus nämlich auch bei uns nur dann gewinnen, wenn wir helfen, den Zugang und die Verteilung der Impfstoffe auch in anderen Ländern weltweit unabhängig vom Wohlstand sicherzustellen. Vielen Dank.
Dankeschön. The word now to Brigitta Sacredeus.
Well, first of all, I want to express that the Committee of Regions are very happy that we have a memorandum of understanding with WHO. And I also want to remind everyone that in 19 out of the 27 member states is the local and regional responsible for the health system. That means that we need to work with best practice, we need to help each other, and I'm looking forward to work with WHO and the Committee of Regions with the health issues. The mental health issues especially is so important during the pandemic, and also it will be after the pandemic. So we are looking forward to work with the WHO.
Thank you very much. Tobias Gotthard, the floor is yours.
Sehr geehrter Präsident, Herr Direktor Kluge, Europas Weg aus der Pandemie wird nur über die Impfung funktionieren. Und ja, wir brauchen dafür Geduld, aber wir brauchen dafür auch aus unserer politischen Verantwortung heraus den vollen Einsatz für die Menschen. Unser Ziel muss deshalb sein, dem Impfwunsch der Bevölkerung jetzt ausreichend und transparent mit Impfstoffen nachzukommen. Wenn das nicht funktioniert im freien Markt, muss man den bisherigen Pfad der europäischen Impfstrategie teilweise korrigieren und Lösungswege suchen. Das hält für mich die Möglichkeit nationaler Notzulassungen, um die Impfressourcen kurzfristig zu erhöhen. Zur Not muss man mit gesetzlichen Maßnahmen gegensteuern, die uns das TRIPS-Abkommen und nationale Patentgesetze bieten. Wo der reine Markt im Notstand nicht funktioniert, muss der Staat entschlossen handeln. Bedienen wir jetzt den Impfwunsch unserer Bevölkerung. Dankeschön.
Danke. Jocke Schauflige, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you, Dr. Kluge, for your very interesting presentation. You have started your career as a family doctor in my home country, Belgium, and you have always been committed to helping the most vulnerable. And this is also very important for the vaccination strategy. Equal access to vaccines is crucial. One of the most vulnerable territories in Europe today are undoubtedly the rural areas. The COVID-19 crisis has magnified many of the known problems in the rural areas. Most importantly, we have to change our way of thinking and make policies also from the perspective of rural areas. In this respect, I hope and I count not only on the European Commission, but also on the international organizations such as the WHO to better consider and target the rural areas. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. The floor now to Bronius Markauskas. The floor to our colleague Lundin. The floor to our colleague Tramka. The floor to our colleague Haglom.
Tack, herr president. Jag tar det på svenska till alla översättare. Här på Åland så är vi 30 000 människor. Vi har haft två på sjukhus. Vi har inte haft något dödsfall, så jag vill bara berätta att vi har klarat den pandemin otroligt bra så här långt. Och kanske WHO borde kontrollera varför vi har klarat oss. För vi har kryssningsbåtar hit till Åland, vi är beroende av turismen. Det har varit ganska nedstängt mycket. Men ändå har vi haft, och vi har haft det mest öppna samhället i hela Europa, vill jag påstå. Så det finns positiva platser i Europa och vi är en av dem. Och vi är lyckligt lottade. Och vi hoppas ni alla andra ska få det lika bra som vi har det. Men välkomna hit och titta hur vi har klarat. Vår regering har varit mycket bra i sin information, men vi har haft ett öppet samhälle. Tack ska ni ha.
Thank you very much. Our colleague Whoop, please.
Ja, Herr Kluge, herzlichen Dank für den sehr interessanten, auch optimistischen und zugleich realistischen Vortrag. Wir haben eine ganze Menge an Hausaufgaben in den Regionen zu erledigen. Wir arbeiten hart an der Bekämpfung der Pandemie hier in Berlin, wie in vielen anderen Städten Europas und sicherlich weltweit. Der Solidaritätsgedanke ist dabei ganz zentral. Den müssen wir stärken, trotz der schwierigen Informationslage und der Herausforderungen und dass den Menschen auch die Geduld ausgeht. Die Impfkampagne ist ganz wichtig. Zu wenige Menschen sind auch bereit, absehbar sich impfen zu lassen und das wird irgendwann wichtig werden. Sie sagen, die Zusammenarbeit ist der Schlüssel, sicherlich bei der Produktion. bei der fairen Verteilung. Das sind die Punkte, die jetzt immer wichtiger werden. Die Produktion ist, denke ich, dadurch gekennzeichnet, dass wir jetzt da das große Defizit haben. Sie sagen, der Impfstoff ist ein globales öffentliches Gut. Dem würde ich auch sehr gern zustimmen. Welche Empfehlung haben Sie, Herr Kluge, wie man das nun organisiert, die Produktion zu steigern, von Ihrem Blickwinkel aus, sozusagen den globalen Blickwinkel bei den verschiedenen Produzenten, die weltweit aufgestellt sind, mit Lizenzfragen und dergleichen mehr? Herzlichen Dank.
Thank you. Our colleague Markauskas, please.
Mr. President, Dr. Kluge, we welcome the European Union and the WHO cooperation in COVID-19 vaccine rollout. A successful vaccination campaign needs engagement of local and regional authorities, especially from rural region, like my own Klaipėda district in Lithuania. With limited doses of vaccines, we are now vaccinating doctors, social workers, and home care residents, and plan to vaccinate teachers next week. Our plan relies on avoidance of major disruptions, such as delays of vaccine supply or transportation, as was recently in the case in Lithuania, where a batch of vaccine was compromised while in transport. How can WHO and the European Commission work with the Committee of Regions to promote cooperation at the local and regional level and effective inclusion of the local and regional authorities in vaccination campaign? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ms. Haapanen, please.
Thank you, Mr. President. I come from northern part of Finland, and our government has been overall informing the citizens quite well about the situation. But moreover, it is very important that the local and regional authorities can react also quickly. So in each town and city, we have a group of people who are able to make a quite quick decisions what comes to the opening the schools or hobbies or public places. So I think this quick to be able to do decisions quickly according to the needs of the community, this is very important, and the good cooperation between the local authorities and local decision makers, politicians, this is important. What I'm really concerned is our youth, and then because they suffer a lot, as well as elderly people, of being isolated. And I think after the COVID, much attention must be paid also to the social well-being and recovery and healing the psychological problems that our citizens might be facing after these hard times.
Thank you very much, Satu. And last but not least, our colleague Pedersen.
Tak for det. Da jeg i 2016 sammen med Dave Wilcox tog initiativet til at skabe samarbejde mellem regionsudvalget og WHO, var det for at skabe sammenhæng imellem WHO, staten og regionerne, for at skabe en vigtig koordination. Og nu har vi jo set her i pandemien, hvor vigtigt det er. Vi så jo, hvordan det i starten af pandemien var lidt vanskeligt at skabe samarbejde, men det er kommet i gang, og vi har nu et godt samarbejde på europæisk niveau. Og derfor var jeg rigtig glad for hr. Kluges ord om solidaritet og internationalt samarbejde som en vigtig forudsætning for at komme videre. Og det er i hvert fald en forudsætning for, at vi sammen kan bekæmpe pandemien. Så jeg glæder mig til et fortsat stærkt samarbejde med WHO, både med hensyn til en stærk energi, men også synergi. Tak for ordet.
Tak. Now I give the floor to Dr. Kluge for your final reaction, and then we will co-sign the Memorandum of Understanding.
Thank you, Mr. President. And I must say that this has been an incredibly rich session, so I will, for the sake of time, not go into detail, but a number of points, particularly those which has been raised directly to me, starting from Ms. Sara Bezoles Nathalie. So on the vaccination nationalism, extremely important point. and several of the colleagues have come back to that one, on the issue of solidarity. In fact, we see this is a very big stress test to solidarity. The solidarity was not optimal in the beginning of the pandemic when we saw different hiccups during the procurement of the personal protective equipment, the masks, etc. So we really have to try to avoid that this happens a second time. And I myself, sitting in Copenhagen here, I'm looking at the 53 member states, so the pan-European region. So I have this even a broader remit. So a number of points, what we are doing, WHO, Europe, is the moral imperative. We stand very strong on the principle of solidarity, both as a moral principle and ethical and pragmatic. Second, we are very active. Also, me personally, every single day, I have calls with leaders, with prime ministers, presidents, with governors on redistribution of vaccines. According to the Duke Global Health Innovation Center, the United Kingdom purchased quantities of the vaccine that equate 5.5 doses per person. In the United States, 3.7. In Canada, 9.6. And we know most of the EU countries have not opted out of any agreements. So while there is a shortage today, the agreements encompass a far higher number of doses than required. So this redistribution is very important. One example, 2 days ago, I had a very productive call with the Minister of Health of San Marino. And there I would like to thank really the Ministry of Health of Italy, because we are working with the Ministry of Health of Italy, the European Commission, Pfizer, on a redistribution. Because sometimes we speak about small quantities. As I mentioned, we're working with pharmaceutical companies also to see how the production capacity can be beefed up. And then very important, we are working with the countries on not only the vaccine, but what we call the vaccination. So the preparedness, because that should not be underestimated. I think many of you have this experience on the legal issues, on indemnity, liability, the cold chain, creating the demand, decreasing vaccine hesitancy, preparing the workforce. So this is a whole spectrum. And in fact, I would like to express appreciation to Commissioner Oliver Varhelyi of Neighbourhood. We're working through support from them in the Balkan and the Eastern Partnership. And I fully support your idea on scaling up production based on licensing within the framework of the WTO TRIPS flexibility. On the governance, this is something that we are studying right now with the European Observatory on Health Systems and Policies, which got looking at how countries were pushing back the pandemic compared with their governance models. And then how to prepare for the future. 2 points here. We are very supportive of the European Health Union, the EU for Health package. I always say a stronger EU is a stronger WHO, a stronger WHO is a stronger EU. And there I would like to reach out to all of you, to your leverage, to watch, to ensure, to advocate that there is a good synergy in the EU for Health between WHO and the European institutions, including a financial contribution, because WHO is asked to do a lot, right? But the resources have to follow. The other issue that we work on very hard, and I mentioned it in my opening remarks for the future, is the Monti Commission. There is a specific working group on international governance. What are the recommendations, including on WHO reform and big international institutions like the International Monetary Fund, which could help for better preparedness for the future? I would like to thank the representative of the Veneto region, Mr. Ciambetti Roberto, also for the support to the WHO office in Veneto, and the agreement is being renewed. Thank you. Inter-regional solidarity was mentioned. This is terribly important. In no way we can go to a society in Europe where it will be survival of the fittest. And this is not so far off. because there is light at the end of the tunnel, but the tunnel will be a little longer than I thought end of December. So the younger people are becoming logically very impatient. So we cannot go back to, and especially with the variants, if people will be reinfected, it means herd immunity. The goal will be pushed back if people will be reinfected, including people who are vaccinated. Now we have to think, do you need a booster in some time? Do we need other vaccines? Like for the flu vaccine, we have to adapt the flu vaccine because the virus is changing. So inter-region solidarity, we need to keep strong. Very nice to see my compatriot, Mr. Karel van Loo from Nieuwpoort. And Madame Chauvely was mentioning I started my career as a general practitioner in Belgium, in fact, in Lombardseide with Dr. Lones and Nieuwpoort with Dr. Sabbe. So my greetings to my home, Mr. van Loo. Next point is on the rural areas. Yes, this is very important. In terms of health workforce, we have more and more what we call medical deserts in rural areas. So this is a priority for the work, strengthening primary healthcare. But also, again, I always try to take a positive view. We have seen a lot of very good examples of digital medical consultations in rural area, including also in Scandinavia. To leave no one behind and protect the vulnerable. Thank you again, Madame Sacredeus Birgit, for pointing out your strong commitment, which I reciprocate, to work together, not at least at mental health. Mental health is really a top priority over here. Thank you, Mr. Hagblum Bert, for to be invited to your region. I'm very curious. I really would like to come. I mean, Sweden is not so far here, because in Sweden as a country, we saw a higher number of cases and deaths compared with other Scandinavian countries. But your region must have done very well, and congratulations. It is possible, absolutely, and this depends a lot on leadership. Well done. And then finally, I welcome the EU Health Legislative Package, right? And I would like also to welcome the efforts of Commissioner Kyriakides in and Commissioner in general on the Advanced Procurement Mechanism and the heads of state of the member states to negotiate with manufacturers the delivery and scale-up of vaccines. And of course, I understand the frustration, but somehow I see this as a silver lining in the darkness, that after the debacle and the mishappening of the procurement of personal protective equipment, the EU somehow pulled itself together for these vaccines. And now we have to work together to hammer out the teething problems. Dear colleagues, I must say this is a tremendously fantastic session. Mr. President, please do invite me. And I'm very much looking forward to a very pragmatic collaboration. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kluge. It was a very interesting debate. Our members enjoyed it, and I'm really looking forward in working with the World Health Organization in the near future. Let us now move to the signing of the Memorandum of Understanding between the European Committee of the Regions and the World Health Organization Regional Office for Europe. And I would like to give the floor for a brief statement to the NAT chair, Ms. Ulrika Landergren, please.
Thank you, President Tsitsikostas and Director Kluge, for this occasion to sign this memorandum of understanding between the Committee of the Regions and your organizations. We have had a very good cooperation between the NAT Commission and the World Health Organization, which has been established for many years ago. Many joint events have been organized between the NAT Commission and the World Health Organization, most notably during the European Week of Regions and Cities. Just next Monday, you have mentioned it, our rapporteur of the health union will be meeting with you and the Oksana Domenti from the World Health Organization in order to discuss the ongoing NAT opinion. Just remind them that the initial for this idea on the Memorandum of Understanding with the World Health Organization came from the current first vice president of the NAT, Karsten Uno Pedersen, who also spoke earlier when he was the chairman of the CORE Interregional Group of Health and Wellbeing. I'm very looking forward to this signing and to continue the cooperation with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Ulrika, for your intervention. Dear Dr. Kluge, this pandemic has served to remind us, above all, how interconnected we are and how vital cooperation and partnership of all levels of government, European, national, regional, local, with global organizations such as yours and the private sector is. So only by working together and by working closer to our communities, we will protect our people, businesses, lives, and our economies. So I really hope that 2021 will be the year of global cooperation that will help us find the way through the pandemic and towards recovery. Because recovery, make no mistake, will start from our regions and our cities. And the strengthening of our cooperation today is an acknowledgement that we need each other with our own competencies, experiences, and knowledge. We must think and act both locally and globally. As I said last time we met, the European Committee of the Regions is your partner, ally, and friend. So the action plan for the next 2 years, embedded in our new Memorandum of Understanding, shows this ambition to cooperate for better, safer, and more resilient cities and regions, for a better world. So let me now propose to you the signing of our memorandum. Dr. Kluge.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. It is my great pleasure to sign now the very important agreement. I will not dwell because you have given me a lot of time to speak already. You know that I'm very committed to the regions. I strongly believe in the principles of leaving no one behind, solidarity and equity, but also in a pragmatic way. We need the partnership. I am a man coming from the regions, from Flanders, from Belgium. So people are telling, if you understand the governance structure in Belgium, you can understand the governance structure in any country. So I'm a great believer of the untapped potential of the regions, and you can count on me. And now, Mr. President, I am ready to sign.
Thank you, Dr. Kluge. I have signed it, so now it is your turn.
Signed, Mr. President.
Thank you very much for this great discussion, this great debate. Thank you for the signing of our memorandum. I'm sure we have great things to do ahead.